A lot of research studies done in psychology and many other sciences are correlational studies. A lot of times when I talk about these studies, students tend to struggle with some of the terms. So in this video, I'm going to use a lot of visuals to help you better understand what goes into correlational studies. Correlational studies are meant to show if two variables are related in some way. In fact, it's actually in the name, correlational. A variable is basically just something. Now, two things can be related to one another, but the strength of that relationship can vary a lot. It can be a strong one or a weak one. I like to think about people in my family. We're all related, but I have a stronger relationship with some family members and a weaker relationship with others. I mean, come on, every family has that Aunt Sally or that Cousin Joe that folks just don't really talk about, right? The way we determine if these variables are related and how strong that relationship is through numbers. So correlational studies are driven by data or statistics rather than by physical observations like descriptive studies are. I mentioned that correlational studies measure variables. So what exactly is a variable? Well, a variable is something that can be measured. It can be quantified, or in other words, a number can be used to measure it. So something like height is a variable because I can measure and compare people's heights, say in inches or centimeters. Weight is a variable because I can measure someone's weight in pounds or kilograms. I have to say, I don't think I've ever been as happy as this guy to be jumping on a scale though. Medicine is also a variable because I can measure the dosage. Importantly for psychology, emotions like happiness can also be a variable. After all, I can measure happiness by asking someone on a scale of 0 to 10, with 10 being the happiest you've ever been and a 1 being the least happy you've ever been, how happy are you right now? It's worth noting that correlational studies measure at least two variables, but they can measure more than that. There are also many different types of correlational studies. However, this video is meant for a general psychology course, and we all still got our training wheels on. So I'm not going to get into a ton of detail about the various types of studies. There are three that I think you all should know about, though. The first is a longitudinal study. A longitudinal study measures data over a period of time. So when you hear longitudinal, think long period of time. This can be going into the future, in which case we call it a prospective study. It can also be looking into the past, where we would call it a retrospective study. A good example of a longitudinal study would be if I wanted to see what effect working a job had on college students' grades. I can follow students over several years and measure how many hours they spent working a job and compare that to their grades. Because this may fluctuate from one semester to the next, I would probably have to collect this data every semester for several semesters, and this is what makes it longitudinal. The next type of study is called a cross-sectional study. These are meant to be a collection of data at one moment in time. So we are not going out over a period of time like we are with longitudinal studies. An example of a cross-sectional study would be if I asked students how much time they spent studying for a test. The two variables would be time spent studying and their score on the test. Because I'm only getting this information one time, this is what makes it cross-sectional. The final type of study is called a cohort study. A cohort study is a longitudinal study, so it usually goes on over a period of time. However, it usually involves a smaller group of people that have something in common, and you're comparing that group or the cohort with the larger population. So let's say that a college starts a new program to help students that are working jobs do better academically. Because this is a new program, the school wants to see if it is effective or not. To do this, they take a group of, say, 20 students and put them in this new program. They take these students and follow them over several semesters as they take part in the new program. They compare the data from the specific group, or the cohort, and compare them to college students in general, or to college students that were working jobs and not attending the program. This way, They can say that if students in the program had better grades or graduated more often, then maybe this new program at the college is helpful. That's what makes this a cohort study. These types of studies are used a lot to see how effective new treatments and therapies can be. I want to move on now and talk about scatter plots. A scatter plot is a visual way of showing if and how strongly two variables are related to one another. This is usually done through a graph called a scatter plot. It consists of two lines. Each of these lines is going to represent a variable. The vertical line is called the y-axis. The horizontal line is called the x-axis. Where they meet is the zero point. So this is where both of the variables we're measuring is a zero. Let's pretend that I want to see if there's a correlation between the time students spend studying in my class versus their final grade. In this case, I will make the y-axis represent the number of hours students spend studying in my class per week. So we start at zero, and we go all the way up to 10. My God, I really hope that no student has to study for 10 hours per week in one of my classes. The other variable is going to be their final grade. So we start at zero and we go all the way up to 100%. Now, say I have a class of 30 students. Each of these dots is going to represent one student. The place of the dot on the scatter plot shows how many hours that student said they studied on average and what their final grade in the class is. So I go down and I place a dot for each student to represent these two variables. The first one studied 5 hours and got 80%. The second studied 7 hours and 90%. And I just keep going. You see these dots tend to show a little bit of a pattern here. They tend to rise up the further we go to the right. This is a positive correlation. A positive correlation means that when one variable increases, like time spent studying, so does the other variable, which is final grade in the class. Notice that I put an addition symbol here instead of writing out positive. This is important because in psychology, we talk a lot about different terms being either positive or negative, and students get confused and assume that means good and bad when it actually doesn't. In this case, the positive just means an increase. Now, let me show you what a negative correlation looks like. So we have another scatter plot here. This time, that y-axis is going to represent hours spent sleeping, and the x-axis is going to represent drowsiness. Where the lines meet is a zero for both variables. Time spent sleeping, I'm going to start with a zero, go all the way up to a 10, which, by the way, if you got 10 hours of sleep, I'm totally jealous of you right now because I definitely did not. The x-axis is going to measure drowsiness. Just like earlier, how I said we can measure happiness, well, we're going to use the same method to measure drowsiness. So I ask people on a scale of 0 to 10, how drowsy or tired are you right now? 10 would represent the most drowsy or tired you have ever been in your whole life, and 0 would be the least drowsy or tired you've ever been. Same thing as before. I'm going to now ask people about these variables, and each of these dots represents one person, and its position is based on those two variables. Say the first person got 8 hours of sleep and said they were at a 5 for drowsiness. The next person got 6 hours of sleep and they were at a 3 for drowsiness. I'm going to keep on going and put in all these little data points, and you can see a pattern starts to emerge. In this case, we see the pattern tends to go down. This is an example of a negative correlation. A negative correlation involves one variable decreasing when the other variable increases. Again, notice that I didn't write out negative correlation. Remember that I said at the start of the video that correlational studies measure if two variables have a relationship and how strong that relationship is. Well, there is a way that we can measure the strength of the relationship between two or more variables, and it's called the correlation coefficient. This starts going more into statistics, though, so I'm not going to tell you the mathematical formula used to calculate it, and I'm sure everybody's really happy to hear me say that. To be honest, you don't even really need to know how to calculate the correlation coefficient in most general psychology classes anyway. What you do need to know, though, is how strong those relationships are. So you see here, we have examples of different types of scatter plots. The first row, we have a positive correlation. All of the data points are arranged perfectly in a straight line. This is a positive correlation because the line is going up the more it goes to the right of the graph. It would also be considered a plus one correlation coefficient. This means these two variables are always present. So when one variable increases, the other will always increase too. It's worth pointing out, though, that this is actually pretty rare in the real world. As we move to the right in this row, you can see that the number below the scatter plot goes closer and closer to zero. You see the same thing in the second row, where we have examples of negative correlations. A negative one is a perfect line that goes down as we move to the right in the scatter plot. The closer we get to that correlation coefficient moving from a one to a zero, the more those data points become scattered. When we reach a zero, it shows that there is no relationship or no correlation at all between the two variables. One of the absolute most important things to keep in mind with correlational studies is that correlation is not causation. There can be tons of reasons why two variables may have some sort of relationship with one another. Many times, this is because of something called confounding variables. Let me show you what I'm talking about by going back to an earlier example. So let's go back to the positive correlation between hours spent studying and final grade in my class. Now, I've never done this study, but I would assume if I did that there would be a bit of a positive correlation between these two variables. After all, students that don't study at all probably aren't going to do very well. However, I couldn't say that hours spent studying causes a good grade in my class. I suggest that you pause the video and think for a second about what could make a student spend a lot of time studying and still not do well in a class. Also, think about the reverse. What could make a student not study very much, but still do well in a class? After you think about that for a little bit, watch the rest of this video. Hopefully, you all paused the video for a little bit and thought about this question. This is important to help transform these videos from just being something you passively listen to into something that really helps build understanding and critical thinking skills. Now, to go back to my question, I know some of the things that came to my mind that can influence the results of our little correlational study here could be that students don't study effectively. Almost every semester, I have students that talk about how they read the book over and over and over again, how they spent hours every week reading and still aren't doing very well in my class. I always ask these students if they like to read, and they almost always say no, they hate to read. Typically, people assume that studying means sitting down and reading a book. If that works for you, great. But for a lot of other people, we're just spending time doing something that isn't really that effective. There are other reasons, though. For example, what if a student took the class before? In that case, they may not need to study as much because they heard the material before. What if a student cheated? Certainly, a student that cheats may get a good grade if they don't get caught, and probably isn't spending very much time studying. Another big factor that can influence these results is how interested a student may be in a class. I remember when I was a student, I used to hate math. I even had to retake college algebra because I just didn't like the subject. Because I didn't like it, it meant that I had to focus a lot more and spend more time trying to learn. I'm sure you can all relate to this. Subjects that you find interesting, you learn quicker than topics you find boring. Well, all of these are examples of confounding variables. A confounding variable is something that isn't being measured, but is influencing the variables that are being studied. I'm sure you may have come up with some confounding variables that I didn't list, and there can be dozens of reasons that explain why I can't say that time spent studying causes a good grade in a class. Another great example of this is that there is a positive correlation between ice cream sales and crime rate. So generally, when ice cream sales increase, so does the overall crime rate. This isn't because people are getting violent because of a sugar high from ice cream. It also isn't due to crime victims eating ice cream to make themselves feel better. In this case, it usually has to do with weather. During the summer, the weather is hot, so people are more inclined to eat ice cream rather than in the winter when it's cold. In many parts of the country, the weather is nice during the summer, and it allows more people to be outside, which can lead to an increase in crime. Even though these two things are correlated, they do not cause one another. So the next time you hear a news report or somebody mention how they heard about a connection between two things, remember that correlation is not causation. Ask yourself, what confounding variable may be causing the results? Thanks for watching, everybody.